Very few politicians can boast of a dramatic entry into active politics. But Overand Bonnie Padmore can. One day he was a public servant, and the next, the Constitution of Trinidad and Tobago was being changed to allow him to become a government senator and join the cabinet of Dr. Eric Williams. Now, that's a grand entrance. If you have a master plan, then I got the vote for you. Worldwide protest movements, radicalism, and youth upsurges of the late 1960s and early 1970s would always be remembered for the catalyst these provided to the way of life in most countries. Here, the Black Power movement resulted in social and cultural change that transformed society. In the parliamentary politics of Trinidad and Tobago, it became necessary to change the face of politicians who represented the government of the day. With the swift exit of government ministers Johnny O'Halloran and Gerard Montano, a public servant named Overand Padmore would be suddenly elevated to a different level of public service within hours. The year was 1971.
Born into a middle-class family on Lewis Street in Woodbrook, Overand Padmore, also known as Bunny, is the third child of five offspring from Overand Padmore Sr. and Gwendolyn Evelyn Padmore. He attended Tranquility Boys and Queen's Royal College before pursuing his undergraduate studies at the University of Toronto in Ontario, Canada. Returning home, Overand Padmore began a career in the civil service, working first at the licensing department and then the Central Statistical Office.
Well, the truth is, after I left university, I did identify a career choice for myself. I did economics and I did a research paper in labor economics in Trinidad and Tobago. And therefore, I thought that I would have liked to become engaged in an advisory capacity to the labor movement in Trinidad and Tobago. And I spoke to one of the Caribbean Congress of Labor senior people here. But it really did not get very far because the indications were that labor leaders might not have taken kindly to somebody coming out of the university to assume that kind of role, because in the minds of many it was suggested to me that they would have seen that as one step removed from wanting to take control of the movement, which of course was the farthest thing from my mind.
That option having not been realized, Overand accepted a position from the Ontario Department of Labor and stayed there for about 18 months until he received an invitation to join the diplomatic service in Trinidad and Tobago. After being at the Ministry of External Affairs in Port of Spain for a year and a few months, Overand was once again back in Canada, now returning as a diplomat, having been posted to Ottawa. In this role, he toured Canada from coast to coast, representing our country throughout the continent. Journalist Andy Johnson analyzes how this exposure may have influenced Padmore's later political life.
I think because Canada, in my time, they had begun officially to experiment with the idea of multiculturalism, but I think unofficially that was the case because it was a different kind of society emerging from colonialism but wanting to embrace the world, and coming from the Caribbean, I think that was very useful for people wanting to live there and then understand the societies in which we were coming from. And again, you know, people like himself, like Ryan, like Mervyn, Sam, like Anthony, Smart, there's a whole generation, a couple of generations of Trinidadians who then became leaders in their own rights, who had that Canadian experience and who put it to the use that it was meant to be.
Padmore's colleague and friend, Dr. Cuthbert Joseph, recalls this period of his life.
Bunny and I, we have so much in common, because we have both come from the same source. I don't want to be too personal. The families have been close. I am not one of those privileged ones who grew up in Port of Spain and went to school either to Queen's Royal or was at Mary's. I'm a South boy. I went to my father's commercial school in Cipriano. I attended what is now Presentation College San Fernando. But The important thing is that Bunny and I came from the same kind of middle class background with the same values and parents or parents, education. And then we found ourselves together in the public service. And he was an economist in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs when I was a foreign service officer in the Foreign Service of Trinidad and Tobago in the early 60s and throughout the 60s. And lo and behold, Bunny found himself being moved from a position of senior economist in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs to be Minister of Petroleum and Mines and Industry and Commerce. It is the way he was put into that position. And I think one of the things that when we were talking about the politics of that time and anything that I shared or we shared, I think one has to put this in the context of the evolution of the political history of Trinidad and Tobago in terms of a new thrust, utilizing what I call technocrat politicians in the advancement of the development of Trinidad and Tobago.
The historic appointment of Overand Padmore is put into context by Dr. Joseph.
After 1970, the country, the body politic, the polity suffered a shock. The party, the PNM, suffered a shock. The region suffered a shock. In fact, in 1970, sort of unease disturbances was part of a global. It was a part of a global protest of youth all over the world, whether it was youth with the civil rights movement, which was not just merely ethnic and black power thing. It had to do with the Vietnam War. It had to do with the way how the youth felt in Europe and how they felt about the whole decolonization process. The way how the youth felt about the nuclear stalemate with all the nuclear weapons hovering over Europe and so on. It was a period of youth processing, youth protests in the world, where you had the youth came into their own with the Jackson Five and the Beatles and so on, and this was reflected here in the Caribbean, and it is at that time you had Eric Williams with his wisdom raided the public service to give a new fillip to give the body politic and the political process a new basis for hope, and introduced the technical people at the political level.
Overand Padmore himself describes the invitation to join the Williams cabinet as totally unexpected. But he held steadfast to the People's National Movement and over the years served in three different administrations, performing under the following portfolios.
Minister of Petroleum and Mines and Minister of Industry and Commerce, May 27, 1971 to February 9, 1973. Minister of Public Utilities, February 10, 1973 to September 14, 1973. Minister of National Security, September 12, 1973 to June 19, 1976. Minister in the Ministry of Finance, September 22, 1976 to March 29, 1981. Minister of Government Construction and Maintenance, Minister in the Ministry of Finance, March 30, 1981 to May 12, 1981. Minister of Agriculture, Lands and Food Production, May 13, 1981 to September 18, 1981. Minister of Education, November 17, 1981 to February 28, 1985. Minister of National Security, March 1st, 1985 to October 29th, 1986. Government Senator, temporary, October 17th, 2002 to September 28th, 2007.
Andy Johnson believes it is Padmore's loyalty to the PNM that accounts for his longevity in politics.
In the end, that is what it is for him, because when the party first went into opposition, I mean, he was one of those who stood there. He'd lost his seat. It was a massive loss for him as well as for several others. But he continued to remain loyal to the party's principle. And that sort of put him at odds with the political leader at the time. And they were for a while he was in the wilderness. But I think it's because of his loyalty to the party and the principles as he understood them that resulted in a kind of rehabilitation to the position where he is now.
Journalist Lennox Grant, commenting on Overand Padmore's return to the parliament under the current administration as a temporary senator, said, quote, "Though he was just holding for National Security Minister Martin Joseph, Mr. Padmore looked like he belonged in the Senate." Grant further noted that an editorial in one of the daily newspapers stated, "Padmore displayed a sophisticated grasp of the many layers of the subject of crime and at the same time addressed senators with a refreshing forthrightness."
But my days of him in the parliament, Padmore that is, covering him, he was always a thunder. He had a kind of booming voice, and very often he had logic, and he brought scholarship and some, you know, he had an exquisite use of the language and how he would put the politics together with the language and his command of the stage in the parliament. He was someone to look to in the parliament. And you got that sense when he would now act as a temporary senator.
Overand Padmore sums up the current practice of politics astutely.
There is an aspect of the politics today that leaves a lot to be desired. I think in the kind of politics that we have, you must be able to have, you know, there's talk about government and opposition talking behind the speaker's chair, reaching decisions on matters which they can implement. That is a kind of arrangement that seems to have fallen by the wayside, because giving one's word doesn't necessarily mean that one will honor the word that one has given. To that extent, I think there is something of a difference between what we have now and what we would have had before. I mean, in the period of time when certainly in the Dr. Williams time, he had been able to work out arrangements with opposition leaders of his day, Rudranath Kapilio and others that held. To my knowledge, I mean, I know under current circumstances, there have been agreements reached between the prime minister and the opposition leader that were honored in one set of circumstances when roles were one way, and when the roles were reversed, they were immediately repudiated. So to that extent, I think that is certainly not an advance over the politics of before. And I mean, and it's something to be deplored.
Looking in retrospect at the politicians like Mr. Padmore, Dr. Joseph sees a different dynamic.
Because he had this training that I referred to, he was a very versatile minister. And no doubt, and that is quite therefore understandable, the use that was made of him at the executive level. Because he was put in the Ministry of, as I say, Industry and Commerce, Petroleum and Mines. Then he was moved to the Ministry of National Security after. Then he was put into Public Utilities. Then he was in Agriculture. In Mr. Chambers' time, he was in Education. And he was in the Ministry of Finance. Because he had this training as a public servant, he was very versatile from a political managerial point of view. And this was quite a positive, and he was very, very useful, because one had to remember this time, and I'm not casting any negatives at the other politicians from different sources, but you had politicians being thrown out by the people, who originally came from other backgrounds by service in the community. But many times they did not have the technical competence to really manage ministries properly.
Having proven himself to be both a politician and a political observer of the past and the present, Overand Padmore shared his vision on current world politics.
Well, what has been described as the New World Order has now become the Old World Order. Just a couple of weeks ago, there was this major G20 meeting in London that in itself represented a departure from those kinds of meetings where it would have been a G7 or a G7 plus one. the wealthy nations of the world, dividing up the world among themselves. And that what was then called the New World Order, based on what was called the Washington Consensus, where they put all developing countries in an impossible straitjacket and forced them to so alter their economic arrangements that it made it very easy for the developed countries to penetrate the developing countries and move away with their natural resources and that sort of thing. The current world economic crisis, a reaction to the irresponsibility that has developed with the tremendous deregulation of the major economic players, will now impose change on the world. And I think it was the Prime Minister of the UK, Gordon Brown himself, who at the end of the G20 said that the Washington Consensus is dead. So that clearly something new is going to have to emerge. It has not yet emerged, but insofar as the world is struggling to get out of the current major economic downturn, the new arrangements that are going to have to be fashioned and put in place would hopefully give smaller countries and developing countries more breathing space with which to develop themselves.
As to his personal legacy, Overand Padmore was once more the diplomat.
I think fundamentally I was happy to know that I was part of a government that preserved the democracy of Trinidad and Tobago, kept us as a political organization faithful to democratic principles on the basis of which we were founded, and to this day still observe. We live in a country where the population does not have fears of the government and that sort of thing, and to the extent that I felt I have contributed to that, that would be an aspect of a legacy that I would obviously have to share with others.
Having already secured a place in the history of parliamentary politics in Trinidad and Tobago, Overand Padmore, most assuredly, has also fulfilled his legacy.